Huh?
Pauli effect.
Oh. I see how it works.
All right, welcome everyone to the third colloquium talk. Today we have Myeongi Kim from the University of Illinois Chicago. She's a roboticist, does all sorts of research related to robotics, motion planning, control, modeling, and human-robot interactions. To talk about her background, she has had a stellar career. She has a couple of MS degrees from Korea Advanced Institute of Technology, KAIST, and one from MIT. And then she went on to get her doctorate from Carnegie Mellon University in robotics. And then she had a postdoctoral appointment with Harvard. And there, along the way, she worked as a control engineer for Samsung also. And her research has been highly recognized in the area of robotics. She has won the Best Paper Award at ICRA 2015. As you know, it is the best conference in robotics. And she has won another Best Paper Award, right?
Yeah, it's both a poster. It's not me, it's my student.
It's really your research.
Yeah.
But yes, today we are very fortunate to have her here and talk more about her latest research on human-robot team, how we can use machine learning to control a wearable robot. So without further ado, let's welcome Dr. Kim.
Hi, thank you for introduction and then invitation. So today I talk about I named as a human robot team. So my research these days are focused on this kind of wearable robots. And then the wearable robots actually need to work with a human subject. So we need to work as a team. So that's why I like say this is a teamwork. And then therefore we need to understand how the human adapts to a robot and how we can control the robot in a nice way to adapt to a human. So like these are my previous research. I researched humanoid and then made ankle prosthesis and then some simulation study for amputees. And then this is a soft exoskeleton, which is a textile-based exoskeleton. So the motivation of my research is that I want to improve and restore mobilities for individuals for impaired mobilities. So there are lots of amputees and stroke patients. And as expected, they experienced a difficulty in working. So like for the numbers. So these difficulties in working actually result in increased the cost of working, especially when they wear the conventional passive prosthesis. And then typically the cost of working is measured using this one device which measures metabolic cost. So metabolic cost is typically measured by using this one device, which is having a mask and then some of this device. So it captures our breath information such as CO2 and O2 and then breath rate. And they can do some calculation and then we can calculate the cost of working. So amputees typically shows the 25% higher metabolic cost compared to everybody counterparts such as like us, or like me. And then 25% next is the number, but it's about 10 kilogram laptops, carrying 10 kilogram laptops all the time. So these days, laptops is about maybe 2 kilogram or so. So like, so therefore, like 25% is actually similar to carrying 25 kilogram weight on your backpack. And means that 25 kilogram is about 50 pounds, which is about maybe 10 laptops. So they experience such a high, the high expenditure on energy usage compared to like us, everybody the counterparts. And then especially it's like when they wear this passive device. So the researchers naturally think about to use on called active device. So active device means that it has a motor and then actuator inside in this device. And then I'll use this device, like having some kind of help from the motors and actuators and like to assist their work. And then the first idea could be getting some control idea from such a humanoid robot, which this humanoid robot, so this is like a robot I researched at Samsung. And then we can perhaps borrow some control idea from this robot and then apply to this active ankle prosthesis. And then will it work? Why not? I ask because it did not work. If it works, problem solved. It's not, typically does not work because the human-robot interaction is not well known. It's very hard to model, and it's from my point of view. So typically, the response is really different. So here's an example. So I think so many of you already know the push-off. So the push-off means that like the proportional energy, and then so this is on. So this is like a study motivated by a simple theoretical study. And then the idea was that if we provide more push-off energy, and then this is an ankle prosthesis, and then we did experiment with like the able-bodied counterparts. So this person wears this ankle prosthesis using simulator boot. And then the idea was that, yeah?
Can I just ask for clarification? Yeah. So the challenge here that you're talking about, the human-robot interaction challenge, is that essentially that maybe the robot part is providing some energy and the human is also providing energy, but it's balancing the two? Is that?
So it can be one issue. And then robot provide an energy to a human subject, but the human subject sometimes responds to the assistance edge or disturbance. Human subject needs assistance, maybe some different, so it's not clear yet, we are still researching it. So I go through later. Sometimes for example, for me, I need maybe 1 joule of energy in the early stance phase. Early stance means the early, when I initiate my gait, my working. And if the assistance comes maybe 10 joules, then I have extra energy and then I need to somehow fight with the energy.
Yeah, okay.
So that's something, it's not well known, but if I come downstairs, I need to somehow reduce my velocity using my muscles. Something like this. It's not clear yet. We do not know how we can somehow make a good collaboration between the human and the robot. So that's why later I'm using machine learning. Good question. Typically the healthy subjects seem to know how to use the assistance, even though we see lots of error bars or standard deviation bar. If we provided more energy, they reduced their cost of working. So this is something we wanted to see for amputees. So actually it's my colleague. My colleague was so excited about this research and then did experiment with amputees. And this is the result. We provided more energy, and then this is the trend. Do you see any trend here? It's like, yeah, maybe it's like maybe here, like maybe around here. Well, anyways, we do not see any trend, and like everything is like all around. So the amputees, I think the amputees try to figure out how it works and how to use it, but like typically they are fighting with this kind of assistance. Actually, it becomes disturbance for them. And then they typically showed much higher energy than their passive device. So this humorable interaction is not well known, and then this is, I identify this with a one of the biggest challenge in our area, and I think it's my colleagues are as well. So I have been solving this problem using computational, like I do simulation or theoretical study, and then also experimental study at the same time to understand like how the theory works and how I can improve some kind of a theory. So this is my simulation work at Samsung, and actually I modified a lot through experiment. And also I used a simplified model to understand the gate, and then tested with the amputee subjects and improved the controller. And then eventually I went to, so I started from the full model, simplified model, and then model free. And then I used model free approach to optimize an assistance in a soft exosuit. So this is a soft exosuit, and then it's textile-based exoskeleton. So my talk today will focus on this aspect. And one of the reasons is that this research is done at Samsung, and still there's a computation issue. So first one is the balance assistance controller for amputees. It's because the amputees showed, as I mentioned, showed high metabolic cost during working. And one of the reasons is that they exert higher energy to maintain balance. So for example, they showed 17% higher metabolic cost, especially when they exposed to uneven terrain. So then we think about why they show higher metabolic cost. And then it's because the balance is least stable into the side-to-side direction. And then they do not have enough sensor and actuator. Maybe that's why they are more lean to falling, and therefore they exert more energy. So to restore balance to any like falling, what do you do typically? What do you do? If you like push here, then I change my footstep. Like I'm doing stepping, another strategy can be like to restore balance, something like this, which is ankle roll resistance. And they turned out that amputees exert having more effort for both of them, and which increase balance related effort. So then we want to somehow reduce such effort using only ankle foot prosthesis. But the problem is that in our field, the ankle is well known as a source to maintain speed or maintain energy. So the reason is that like when you take a step, so then you lose some energy due to collision. And then this push-off provide a little bit energy, and therefore you can maintain speed. So it's like the eighth, at least like 5 years ago, whenever we talk about ankle is for sagittal plane, well, this XZ plane, and it's more like the energy. And then we think about whether actually ankle can do something for balance. And then therefore we made a simplified model to understand the role of the ankle on balance. And then when you look at this figure, we found out that actually we live in three-dimensional world. So therefore there's a finite distance between our center of mass and stance foot. So it's like a little bit physics. So like this force actually leads into medial lateral force, and then actually we can change medial lateral acceleration. Like medial lateral means the side-to-side acceleration. So by changing this push-off, we can change this side-to-side acceleration. So it seems like the ankle can do something, and then there's another question. Then if the ankle can do something, how much it can do? So like, for example, let's say, like so before I said, that foot placement is important source to restore balance. And then let's say the contribution to restore balance for the foot placement is 100. And then let's say later we found out the ankle do something, but the contribution of the ankle is 1. Then there's nothing, like there's no kind of a benefit because still the dominant factor will be the foot placement and the ankle. So it makes sense only if the ankle can do something compared to foot placement, right? So like we can, 100 plus 1 is almost 1, 100 still. Like the ankle should be something like maybe at least 50 something, then we can improve balance somehow using ankle. So the way to compare the relative importance is the simulation study. So that's why we made a simplified three-dimensional the dynamic working model with a hip and ankle. So the I know that there are lots of computer science audience here. For them, 1,000 lines are nothing, but I need to write the 1,000 lines of the equation of motion for this, even if it's simple. And then we implemented this model and then implemented called step-to-step controller. The step controller works only once per step, and then it samples states once per step, and then decide parameter input, which I'll show later, edit step, depending on the state deviation from the nominal value. And then this model should take another step, and then I have a demo virus that does not work here. And then, so the parameter input can be foot placement and the ankle resistance and the push-off work. So what it, like simply what I did was that if the my side-to-side velocity is higher or higher, like in this direction, then I like have wider step width at each step, or I change the push-off work at each step. That's the basic idea of this controller. And then we need to compare the effectiveness of each control method between foot placement and maybe push off. So the way is that we provided random ground height disturbance. So this model worked 100 steps until it fell down. And then we provided this unknown ground height disturbance whenever it takes a step. So we provided lateral impulse at each step, and then we compared the effectiveness of each controller. And then surprisingly, we found that this push-off work control worked best compared to other control input. So the y-axis is maximum tolerable ground height disturbance, and the x-axis is the individual control input we considered. So the push-off work is the work we really like we can do in an ankle foot prosthesis. And then what and then this height disturbance means that we increase the level of disturbance until model fell over, means that the higher number of the disturbance is the number is higher, means that the model can restore balance from the higher disturbance. So higher number is better. If turned out the push-off work controller worked the best. And then the initial response when I talked about this result in a conference is that the initial response was your model was wrong. There's something wrong with your model. It can't be true. Because everybody thought that this should be it's switched somehow. This should be foot placement and this should be push-off. Because all the consensus in this field was that foot placement is a balance, push off is energy. So that's why like I So like my advisor and I went through all this code line by line and then see if there's anything wrong. And then if there's nothing wrong, and then the next response is that your disturbance, it's something wrong about your disturbance. So that's why we also provide this disturbance. But like even for this disturbance, the trend was similar. And even the change the speed, we did able. And then in the beginning, we did LQR. And then later, we expanded to CMAES, which is one of the genetic algorithms. So anyways, other things, like we did lots of trial and then tested, and then this still worked the best. So this is great that we can do something using push-off. But like as I mentioned, this is only theoretical study or computational study, and it may not work as we expected in an experimental study. So the next step was that we need to implement it on hardware. So therefore, we made a hardware here, which is a 2 degrees of freedom encoded prosthesis, and which has 2 independently actuated toes. So therefore, it can provide plantar flexion and then inversion, eversion. And this device can provide human-like torque and also maybe looks very light. And this device actually, this ankle prosthesis end effector, which you just saw, is actuated by 2 large motors. And then upward controller, which is a we can implement control in Simulink or even Python, and just need to have a UDP communication. And then this control signal comes to the tether. And maybe, I'm not sure you are familiar with the motion capture system error. So we can use the motion capture system, which is camera information, and then the treadmill information as a sensor. Like we can use almost all the sensor information and then to control this device. And then the purpose is that whether like try to implement our control idea as much as possible and then see if the control idea would work. And then if the control idea works, then we can maybe make maybe mobile portable version for actual commercialization. But before that, we need to figure out whether actually it works. And then this is the setup to figure out whether it works. And also, this is typically for mechanical engineering people, but like we can also test a bandwidth test, which shows high bandwidth for plantar flexion and inversion. And this is like for fun. So we can also provide a position disturbance while regulating torque. So one tool provided torque position disturbance, and then the other tool can provide torque disturbance. And then we found out that like this torque regulated tool can maintain 30 Newton meter torque up to 18 Hertz position disturbance. So this is a really good device. I'm selling my device. I'm not commercialized yet. And it can provide a wide range of torque, maximum inversion, and then like the inversion torque. And you see, we can provide up to 120 Newton meter without any problem. And then also maximum 30, and then 30 inversion torque, which is a human-like torque range. So you can really test lots of ideas. And therefore, using this computational study, I got lots of control ideas, and then implemented in an ankle prosthesis. And then I was able to write maybe wrote three papers and still preparing this final paper. And this is more like the push-up controller, how it works. So we measured the side-to-side velocity. So we measured the lateral velocity. And then using motion capture system. And then we decided the push-up work at each step. And therefore, when this subject works, like it looks like working normally, but this subject received different level of energy at each step. So you can think of like when you take maybe a step or a little bit higher step, this device provides higher energy, And then when you take like the step, when you going to hole, you are maybe you have like increased energy, also you have increased lateral velocity. Then this device provides less energy. It's like we need to have a, I need to have like a board here. Anyways, so using this setup, I was able to reduce the cost of working by 6% for the simulated amputees and then for amputees by reducing the foot placement control effort, like this effort, and the ankle inversion effort. So this is like the first metabolic cost reduction related balance. And still, people try to figure out how we can reduce metabolic cost for amputees. So this is the first, and then I think no one hasn't been broken my record yet. And there are lots of small details, and I didn't disclose all the details yet. So the cool thing is that ankle foot prosthesis can be served as a balance assistive device. Another good thing is that we can actually do better than we can do actually better. So maybe like this error bar, like have you ever seen such a like high standard deviation bar before? Really? Wow, it's surprising. Like when I show this kind of slides, then people say that this is like too high, like anyways. So for human subject experiment is very typical, but like other field, for like the robotics field, it's very small, like this, maybe like this is small. For human subject experiment, it's very typical because inter-subject variability. So anyways, it means that some subjects reduced 25% metabolic cost compared to no assistance condition, but another subject actually increased metabolic cost by 9%. So it's a shame on me. I actually gave a hard time to a subject. So I need to do better. And then I was fortunate to do research more at Harvard. Anyways, so this is my hypothesis. Our hypothesis that why we saw high inter-subject variability. So because each individual is very different, so especially for the shape, I am very different like you guys. So therefore, their responsive metabolic cost landscape will be different for each individual. So for example, for me, I may work better for smaller energy, but for the high, heavy, maybe, higher weight people than me may work better for the maybe higher energy.
Is there, when you're doing these tests, is there an amount of time that they're sort of learning to use this device?
Yeah, so we actually provide 2 days of learning.
Okay.
So yeah, learning is also very important. Mm-hmm. So we are. So one of the direction you are currently pursuing is the how we can accelerate the learning period.
Yeah.
Actually, so one of the important factor one of the reason I was successful to reduce metabolic cost was that we developed a special learning protocol for amputees. So before, we also had a learning protocol how to use the device or how to use the controller. Before the learning protocol, all the amputee subjects really hated my device. So we also get a user's feedback, user feedback survey. And then let's say zero is their prescribed device. And the subjects showed maybe negative even 5 or negative 3, means that they didn't like it. But after learning protocol, they changed their rating and then they reduced metabolic cost. After learning protocol, the number was changed from maybe the minimum was 0 and then or 1. And then everybody actually flipped. We saw the flipped graph. So learning is important. That's also one of the area we are working on. Yeah, it's a very good question. And then, so for even like for my thesis study, we recruited the already trained subject to minimize learning period, to have a controlled experiment. So we also only focused on the how device adapt to a subject without any learning effect. So this is like actual motivation, not going that direction. So anyways, the optimal point of a message of this slide is that the optimal point of the person A and the person B could be different for some unknown reasons, for at least for me. And if we use this control parameter to person A, this person will increase the cost of working. So it means that we need to somehow optimize parameters. It means that we need to tune the control parameters. So now, like you are looking at this soft exosuit, textile-based exoskeleton, and then this is hip assistance and not ankle assistance, because I changed the research institute. And then still, the idea is the same. We can provide assistance throughout gait. So gait cycle means that this is a gait cycle. Like can be one stride or one step. But depending on the gait cycle, we can provide assistance in a little bit early, or we can provide assistance a little bit late, like a little bit late. And then typically, the conventional practice was that we can provide maybe 5 different assistance, and then measure metabolic cost for each condition, and then fit the data to a curve, and then find the best possible condition. That was the conventional method. And then it's still, I think the clinically still, it is the one of the method the clinician does. But the problem is that this metabolic measurement, because we are metabolic measurement is done by this breath. So therefore it's very noisy and very slow. So it takes about 5 minutes to measure one condition. And if we're talking about like 5 different conditions, it takes about 30 minutes. So it's not that bad, but if you want to optimize maybe 1 and 2 conditions, like the peak timing and then offset timing, then the subject need to work about 2 hours. Still, it's like maybe descent exercise. But if we want to assist hip and ankle at the same time, and if we have 4 parameters, then the subject need to work maybe, 2 days without sleeping. So the one of the biggest challenge in the human subject experiment is that we have a really fixed experimental time budget. We can't ask for maybe even 1 hour is too long. We see the fatigue. So therefore we need something very smart algorithm to solve this problem. So this is like what I did for this research, so we actually decided to optimize these parameters online while including human in the loop. That's why it's called human in the loop optimization. Now again, the challenge is this noisy and then very slow metabolic measurement. So this is our actually the measured data. So we can see there's actually line is here because I draw a line. I think without any line, it may look like it's very hard to know where is the metabolic cost. So like it means that we need something very noise tolerant algorithm, noise tolerant, and then also you have a very limited time budget. So therefore the sample efficient, and then we do not know how the landscape looks like. So it means that we need non-parametric optimization method. So we searched for something noise tolerant and then non-parametric and then sample efficient algorithm. And then we found that there is a called Bayesian optimization. So Bayesian optimization is a sample efficient and then noise tolerant method. And it just fit the data to a curve using Gaussian process. So it's really non-parametric, except there's the Gaussian assumption, but it still works well. And then depending on this landscape, it selects the best possible parameter very quickly. So for maybe 1D problem, we had a toy problem with 1D. It was able to identify the optimal parameter in 10 minutes. So we solved the toy problem first, and then we applied the algorithm to optimize assistance parameters in soft exosuit, which is textile-based exoskeleton. And this is the textile, and then actuator is around here. Have a quick water break. Sorry.
Just out of curiosity, yeah. Wondering how this works. Does it pull the,
yeah,
the thigh back and,
yeah,
forward?
So this is how it works. It's a video. Yeah, it's like it's pulled. So it's like hip extension assistance. So it pulls the thigh,
okay,
to the backward.
Only backwards?
Yeah. Because it, like, it's only unidirectional. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then we used metabolic rate to measure cost, and then we optimized peak and offset timing. And then this is actually the graph you saw online. So we put the data to a curve whenever we get our data from the soft exosuit, and then select the best possible method and then provide the assistance. And then we found optimal condition about 20 minutes. And the result was that.
Quick question.
Yeah.
How many parameters were you trying to optimize in this 20 minutes?
Yeah, it's like it was two parameters. You
okay.
can see, like, we optimized this peak timing and the offset timing.
Okay.
So, like, still it was like huge improvement compared to the previous one.
Okay.
And then you are able to reduce metabolic cost of more than 17%. That's a good thing, and it was even compared to those conditions. Typically, like when you look at a paper in our field, you typically see powered off conditions. But like we even like offered all these exoskeleton, and then compared to like actual normal working. So actually, it's much easier to work with our like this kind of conventional clothes. And another important finding was that each subject almost show very different optimal timing. So the subject 3 and the subject 4, like x-axis is a peak timing corresponding to this, and the y-axis is the offset timing corresponding to here, like a peak and offset timing. And then subject 3 and then subject 4 showed very different timings, means that each individual, suggesting that we didn't do any like rigorous theoretical study. So this the individualized assistance, it seems to be important. And then another important finding was that this standard deviation or the error, standard deviation is about 3% only. So almost all the subjects reduce metabolic cost more than 10%. So we were so excited, and also as we like had a hypothesis, so this is landscape for each subject, the metabolic cost corresponding to peak timing and offset timing, and then this optimal timing was very different among each individual. So like if you apply this timing to subject 6, this subject will actually increase metabolic cost. So we just saw that like individualized assistance, we were able to reduce metabolic cost by 17% and using Gaussian process and then using Bayesian optimization. But if you want to assist full parameters, this algorithm is still not enough because like it is still, we saw maybe 20 minutes for two parameter optimization. If we were doing full parameter optimization, we may need to do about 2 hours still. So we need a more sample efficient algorithm. So therefore, we implemented a call. We developed another algorithm which coupling the metabolic cost and the optimization method itself. So for this, we try to optimize the hip and ankle parameters. And then in the conventional way, we just waited for up to maybe 40 breaths or 2 minutes, and then choose the best possible method. But new method is that if the current condition is seem to be hard, then we just stop early. So therefore, you can save some time to optimize. The idea is very simple. The hard condition, just stop. And then therefore, it's good for the subject. And we can save some time for us as well. So that's why what is said, like metabolic, we couple the metabolic estimation and then page optimization. And then we were able to do it because we used the Kalman filter, and then we were able to see kind of also like how certain we are that this condition is really bad. So we use this method to optimize four parameters. So basically, we coupled the metabolic cost estimation to the optimization process to address the limited time budget for human optimization. So now we look at these two more graphs. We are looking at the metabolic estimator. And then by doing so, we can achieve much larger number of iterations compared to conventional method. Then we try to optimize now six parameters for the heap optimization, like not two parameters. So we optimized almost all the parameters. And then we did some pilot study, and then we were able to reduce metabolic cost about 35% for one subject. And then we also did four parameter optimization, which is for the hip and ankle, and then they reduced metabolic cost more than 30%. So it seems like we can even achieve more by optimizing higher number of parameters with higher with the extent like with hip and ankle assistance. And then this is a summary what it did. So we optimized for the hip. Almost all the parameters, peak, onset, peak, offset timing, and then this curvature, and then peak force. And then this is the result after optimization. So this orange curve is a reference, and then blue curve is the optimal condition like after optimization. And see that these two curves are really different now. And then for the hip and ankle optimization, we optimize these two parameters for the hip, and then optimize these two parameters for the ankle. And then we were able to see more than 30% reduction. So seems like personalized assistive device really important, or individualized assistive device is really important. Any questions so far? Not really.
Yeah. So are these like the normal people or like weights?
Yeah, it's like the normal people in weights.
Okay, so they already use some sort
of it's a lot. So we already only recruited very experienced subjects. So therefore we can rule out any adaptation effect at the time. So like we can only look at almost, we assume that they already know how to use the device.
Yeah, I was wondering if there was an effective.
Yeah. So it was even 1 day protocol, so there was no even training days. So, well, at least like we see that even for them, if we optimize parameters better, we can even reduce metabolic cost a lot. So I'm looking like more like towards to human robot co-adaptation part. So one of the efforts is to design a robot, but without any model. So we are doing purely data-driven approach. So even for like try to design a controller without any model information, and then try to implement in an actual robot. So this is a lab in Korea, and they are providing hardware, and we are providing controller. And also, we apply the same principle to estimate metabolic cost. And then we want to estimate metabolic cost for amputees. And then we are actually also collaborating with Northwestern University as well. Actually, they are giving us lots of feedback. And also this algorithm actually won the best post award, which not me, like she won the award this year. And it's in our web, like MIE, like our university website. And then this is like the training protocol. It's really loud. So another important aspect is the human adaptation. So we designed called enforced exploration period, which is a specialized training protocol, and how the training protocol can change the response of the subject. So this subject, like, so this is before the training protocol. And then this is, the, I think, the best condition, like, so it's like, this is the 10% metabolic reduction compared to powder of a condition, and then maybe 9% metabolic cost reduction compared to the powder of a condition. And then we did nothing. We just went through like 10 minutes of the exploration period. And after that, this subject reduced metabolic cost about 25%. And then like we see clear the ABA condition means that still the best, the already optimized condition is better for this subject, but with the training, the subject can actually work, like the controller assistant works better. I mean, like the team works like greatly with a specialized enforced exploration. So this is something we are also actively like doing research. And then with that, this is my last slide. Then my previous advisors and the coworkers, and then this is my current team members, and then I really appreciate their work. And then my funding resource. I have a little small funding right now. Any questions?
Question.
And thank you for listening.
You have a very exciting talk. So I don't think we get to see the applied side of optimization, and we talk a lot about optimization.
Oh, yeah.
We have kind of like different data-driven approaches, but I think our students will be very excited to see how it's being applied.
Yeah.
Used in like actual applications.
Yeah, any idea of like data-driven approach, I'm very excited to apply it.
Yes.
We have like this nice setup. This setup is that it's very easy to implement any. If you have a Python code, it's very easy to us to implement Python code. MATLAB code is also very easy to implement.
Yes.
So,
yeah,
any idea is more than welcome.
That's a good opportunity for our students. So, if you want to try some,
AI
technique, yes,
yeah,
it can help.
You can really great help for us also, like in this society, in this research area, and then eventually for the individuals with impaired mobilities.
So I have a quick question.
Yeah.
So you worked on you have like maybe 20 plus parents on some
planners.
And everything, right? So for like motion planning, do you like use a theoretical approach or maybe like data driven approach? How do you
like
do
long
the motion
times
planning?
Ago it was. I think it's more like data-driven approach at the time even. It's like a sample-based technique, like the RRT, like something like
okay.
this. And also we even made more data to more efficiently sample.
Okay.
But
so I assume that you tried the theoretical approach before, right? For like the
Yeah.
So you found that the data-driven approach works better.
Well, I think it should, it should be a kind of a combination, I think.
Okay.
Even for like data, so data-driven approach needs like lots of data.
Yes.
That's the downside of the data-driven approach, especially for patients. It's very hard to collect lots of data.
Yeah.
So it's good to have a kind of a theoretical study, and they can be used, so the data can be used to modify the model or the theory. And then therefore eventually like you can use very efficiently use the data. That's
so you already have a kind of a model and then you augment the data and results on top of that. Okay.
Yeah, so that's something like we are also trying to. So we already have even for the metabolic cost, we already kind of model already.
Okay.
And
so
then using data we want to modify the model.
Okay.
So
so these planners are mostly kinematic first, and then you incorporate the dynamic effects later?
Yeah, I think it's more like when I like model, like it's not it could be kinematics, but I try to figure out what is the most important factor.
Okay.
And then for this, like the computational simulation study, it also works very well.
Okay.
Like to see if what is the most important factor,
okay,
typically.
Okay. Any questions in the audience? Ali? You're interested in rehabilitation robots, right? Mm. You have questions?
Yeah.
Okay. I have one more question.
Yeah.
So I saw that you work with a lot of soft textile-based robots. One of the notorious things about these soft actuators is their hysteresis.
Yeah.
What type of control are you using? Because when you try to control, there's also a huge dead zone and hysteresis. So how did you?
What does that mean?
Hysteresis means like the memory effect. So you have an input and output,
mm-hmm,
right? So the input, when you remove the input, it doesn't follow the same line, it follows a different line.
Yeah.
So that means it's like a loop. So depending on where you stop, you're coming back on a different route. So this makes the model hard and difficult to control.
Yeah. So depending on the, I think, application, for like a legged robot, we have a kind of very like repeated motion. We can use the iterative learning controller.
Okay, so basically a learning model.
Yeah, like so you can learn the model. So we have a basic model already.
Okay.
And then on top of that, we can have iterative learning controller. So therefore, it can compensate such effect.
Okay, so basically a lookup table.
Yeah, but it's learning the new trajectory as time goes by collecting data.
Like a sophisticated lookup table.
Yeah. Something like that.
Multi-dimensional.
Yeah.
Okay. How effective is it? Is it good?
So, at least for my application, yeah, it worked well.
Okay.
But I think it's depending on application, because for my application,
yes,
we are doing like working.
Yeah.
It's very repetitive. So
it's,
so it's very easy. Like model itself is not that hard. And also like the data itself is not that hard. But like for different application, it may be different.
Yeah, I mean, the other thing is you are basically assisting.
Yeah.
It's basically like a little component, right?
It'll be different.
Yeah, okay.
No, I was just thinking, so if this was just to follow up on what you just said, if this was all kind of productized, like the hip assistance thing, somebody could come in and then they would just, you had the sort of mandatory training or whatever,
do that
for half an hour or something like that,
and then
walk out the door with it and they would be good.
Yeah, that would be great. Well, that's
no, I know that that's a leap to get to that.
Yeah. We'll get there. We'll get there. Yeah.
When you are working on the human subjects, for, let's say, upper extremity or lower extremity rehabilitation, I know that there are many groups all over the world that are working on this stuff. When you need to collect data from able-bodied, you need to provide a lot of sources, let's say expensive sources. For example, the time that you need to spend to collect data from normal subjects. Is there any standard data set in the world that you can collect, you can use that data without spending more money for that part of the research, or you should collect data for your own?
As far as I know, I do not see the data set yet. It seems like also, I think also the intervention, like there's also a kind of a purpose for, like if I want to develop a controller, then the experiment protocol could be slightly different for each research. So therefore maybe, but also there's some data set for like maybe kind of a common research, such as the meta, like the Bayesian optimization I showed the TOEIC examples. My previous group also posted the data on web page, and then the previous group also posted data on web page because it's like very easy to replicate it. It's like a common research like platform. So I think if it's a common, can be a common research platform, it's I think the problem is that it's not well organized. It is somewhere, and if you dig into the papers, and you can find it. But do not. I personally didn't see, like the published data set.
So basically, it's a repository. You dump the data, and somebody can use it if they know how to use it.
And it's also depending on the PIs. But I think like for my previous research, I posted it somewhere.
Okay. One question?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I want to go back to the basics, right?
Yeah.
So you use this state parameters and state model.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So then I'm wondering, how did you incorporate your data to this model?
The data means the, so the data from the human subject to a model.
Yeah.
So like for, so the one, so the, second question. So the model needs lots of states. So we, when you design the model, it needed like the center mass, velocity, position, heat position. So I think anything needs a state or a variables. But for the when we actually conduct experiment, we can look at only maybe center of mass, velocity, and position, and the anchor. So we need to find a map, like kind of whether it works. So we actually ran neural network as well as the another algorithm to find out what's the most important parameter. And then we figure out the most important parameter and see if, like, how we can make the model stabilize with only one or two sensor information. That there was in between there was another step, like try to find out the most important parameter to stabilize the model. And then we use the model, we use the sensor information to design a controller for actual human subject. Does it make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. Does it answer your question? So, yeah, there was like a model, and we can't get all this sense information from human subject. So, we needed to have another next step.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So, unless there are more questions, we can thank the speakers for the round of applause.
Thank you.